Support for this podcast is brought to you by the Wyoming Humanities. We take a closer look at our human experiences and use stories to explore culture, history, and contemporary issues. You can find us on thinkwhy.org.
The stories sort of come out of the experience of being the kind of wrong kind of Indian in Wyoming, is the sort of joke I use.
Hello, I'm Emmy DeGrappa, and this is What's Your Why? Each week we bring you stories asking our guests the question why. We learn about their passion, why they do what they do, why should we care, and what can we learn? What better place to explore the human landscape than from the state known for its incredible landscapes, Wyoming? And what better organization than Wyoming Humanities? Serving our state for over 45 years, we share stories, ideas, and wisdom about the human experience. Welcome to What's Your Why? Today, we're talking to Nina McConigley. Nina is a writer, professor, and recipient of the Penn and High Plains Book Awards. Welcome, Nina.
Thank you for having me.
Tell us the name of your book and what inspired you to write it.
The name of my book is Cowboys and East Indians. It's a collection of short stories. There are 10 stories in it, and they're sort of a little bit all based in a tiny bit of autobiography. I was born in Singapore, but my family moved to Wyoming when I was 10 months old. My father is a geologist. He's from Ireland. My mom is from India. And so I have a sort of biracial identity. I look pretty Indian, but I think of myself as biracial. And the stories sort of come out of the experience of being the kind of wrong kind of Indian in Wyoming, is the sort of joke I use, but being the kind of Indian that a lot of times growing up, people would come up to me and say, what tribe are you? Or ask questions about identity because they weren't sure what I was. And, you know, Wyoming is a pretty white state. And so growing up definitely was often the only person of color in the room or Indian around. So I wanted to write a book sort of about the rural Indian, or the rural immigrant experience, not even Indian, but the rural immigrant experience, because I think a lot of fiction and writing today talks about being an immigrant, but it's in places like New York or Houston or California, where there is kind of an infrastructure of grocery stores or restaurants or just other people. But being an immigrant in Wyoming can be pretty isolating because there aren't those things. We didn't have Indian grocery stores, and we drove to Denver, 280 miles from Casper, to get groceries. There were no Indian restaurants in Casper, and we really didn't know that many other Indian families growing up because we moved to Wyoming in the late 70s.
What was your experience in school being a person of color growing up?
You know, I don't want to paint a picture that Wyoming was bad. I think there's no frame of reference. Like, I think people often just didn't know how to place me. And again, that sort of thinking of asking what tribe I was, it's just confusion of what are you? And that's a question I think about all the time. What am I? I don't know, because I am biracial. I'm both Irish and Indian, but I look very Indian. So my experience, you know, Wyoming is, I don't think it's a horrible racist place. I think almost every incident I've had where something odd has happened, it's been a weird moment of misunderstanding or ignorance. It's not someone being overtly awful. I think the only time I've ever had that happen was just right after 9/11. I think there was a little anxiety about what I was or who I was. Otherwise, it's been pretty okay, but definitely that experience of being pretty isolated and being kind of the only different person has led to me to think about identity a lot and write about it quite a bit.
And so in your experience as a professor at the University of Wyoming, what kind of lessons do you impart to your students?
You know, at the University of Wyoming, I teach post-colonial literature and Indian literature, along with other things. But I get to teach writing of places and people that I am really interested in. Always on the first day of class, because I teach Indian Lit, I always have a student that raises their hand and it says, wait, this is... This is a Native American lit? And I'm like, no, it's East Indian. But my students, you know, even students from really small rural towns in Wyoming, they're really interested. They want to know about other cultures. They want to know about other places. And it's also, I certainly know this for myself just growing up in Casper. You don't have to think about race very often in Wyoming because it's not really hitting you in the face very often. So I think sometimes it's pretty amazing for students to all of a sudden, you know, think about issues of cultural appropriation and, you know, what it means to be a little bit different in in the world. Also, we're getting into a more global world all the time. I mean, I have engineering students who they may be engineering and they think, oh, I don't even want to read lit, but they are probably going to meet a lot of other Indians in their life and in that world. And so I find most of my students are really, not even most, almost all of them are incredibly open and interested and just really want to know because it's so different from their experience, I guess, growing up here. If they're from Wyoming, if they're even from Colorado and other places, I think they're still pretty interested.
Is there a place for you to teach cultural competency to students to help people understand how to deal with people in other cultures and be understanding and empathetic?
I mean, I hope by just reading fiction that you become an empathetic person. I mean, I think for myself as a writer, I always hope that what I'm writing and creating will create empathy, that someone will think, oh, I mean, I've had a lot of people, I've done book clubs all over the state of Wyoming, and I've had a lot of people come up to me and say, I just never thought about race in Wyoming before. I never thought about what it must have been like for you to grow up and be the only person of color in a room all the time. And if anything, I'm hoping that in reading literature from other people and other cultures, that people will have a moment where they think, oh, this is what it's like to inhabit somebody else's shoes. This is what it's like to think about being different. Because it's not something I think that a lot of people in Wyoming have to think about a lot of the time. We're not that racially diverse. And that's partly also why I feel like I want to teach at the University of Wyoming. I love Wyoming and I love being here. I can't imagine living anywhere else. But a lot of my friends say, how can you live there? And I think, well, A, look at the landscape and, you know, the easy answer, you see mountains and trees and open. But I think it's even more important so that people realize, like, there are people that grew up in Wyoming that are of color and we like to stay here. And I hope that I can show a different perspective of what people think the typical Wyoming person is.
Oh, that's wonderful. What or who inspired your writing?
Wyoming.
Wyoming, really?
I think Wyoming. I mean, I remember at my thesis defense for my MFA, my thesis advisor said, you know, Wyoming seems like one of the main characters in your book. And I thought, it's probably true. I think because I come from two different identities, I come from this Indian and Irish background, I don't necessarily know which of those backgrounds I relate to because I look Indian, but I don't speak Tamil. I haven't really spent that much time in India growing up. I look so different from my Irish family. I think what I've really latched onto is my Wyomingness and my Western. And I think that to me is the thing that really drives my work. I think the land, that sparseness, I think my prose is pretty sparse. I'm not really very lyrical. And I think that's because to me, the land is pretty sparse. Not sparse. I mean, obviously it's full of amazing things, but the landscape is, especially around between Laramie and Casper, can be a little bleak. I think that really drives my work. I would say Wyoming the most.
Do you have a favorite author that you looked to when you were becoming a writer? And
yeah, I always say this. The epigraph to my book is from Laura Ingalls Wilder. It's Ma Despised Indians, which I realize is actually a very negative thing coming from that book. But I grew up loving Little House on the Prairie. I thought those books were the best books possible. I think it's because I think of my parents as a new kind of pioneer, coming to a different place, immigrating, going into the unknown. I think those things are very similar to Laura's family trying to come, kind of go west and make a life and homestead. But I think her prose is pretty sparse. I mean, I actually love that. I think those Little House books are so unsentimental. I mean, she'll be like, pause, crops failed, Mary became blind. And then she just keeps going. She doesn't explain anything. And I really look to her as a sort of guide about not being sentimental in fiction because I think she does it so well and so perfectly with so few words. So she is like my big, and I know she's a children's book writer, but really those books inspired me quite a bit.
I remember reading those books
too. Pretty great.
It's true. How did being immigrants influence your mom and dad? I mean, what do you think was their experience? Because did they speak the language?
Yeah, I mean, my dad's Irish, so he had moved to the U.S. when he was a teenager. So he, you know, he's been here longer. My mom had come to graduate school in the U.S. and then gone back to India. But I mean, Wyoming was not what she expected. When we got transferred from Singapore, she looked up Wyoming in an encyclopedia. She went to the American Library. Of course, she saw the Tetons and Yellowstone. So she thought, oh, great, we're moving to the Alps. I mean, she did not realize we were moving to an oil and gas town. I love Casper and it's absolutely beautiful, but if you don't know it, it can be bleak when you arrive. And we moved in October and she just thought, no, we're not living here. I mean, the wind alone, she thought, no. The first year or so we lived in Wyoming, she did not unpack. She thought we were not staying. Try to get another transfer. And then at some point, you know, my mom shifted and really became invested in the place and really got involved. And my mom is a former legislator in Wyoming. She's the first person born in India to be actually elected to a state legislature, and that happened in Wyoming. So kind of rare that could happen, I think, in other states.
Wow, that's an amazing accomplishment. What's her name?
Mimi McConnachly. Yeah, she was in the legislature in 1994. She led the way before all the other Indians ran for office, but she's the first person.
You must be proud of her. That's great.
I am.
So here's our deep humanities question.
Okay.
How does what you do help us understand humanity more deeply?
I think whenever you're telling stories, you're understanding humanity more deeply. I think whenever you're telling a story, you're walking around in someone else's shoes. I talked about empathy before. I think you just have empathy with fiction. I think you also enter a world you don't ever sometimes know or understand. And you get to think about characters in difficult situations or stories of people that you just hadn't imagined. And, you know, I don't know anything about the Congo, but I just read Heart of Darkness last week. And, you know, it just puts you in a different place. And I think that makes our humanity broader. The more we know, the more diverse fiction we read, the more worlds we know, the better and bigger person you are. For me, that's something I really hope, not only for myself and for my own fiction, but for my students. I really want them to, I want their world to be bigger. I want them to think about people in all sorts of situations and all over the world.
I want to finally ask you, there's always this struggle between the sciences mm-hmm. versus the teaching mm-hmm. of the humanities. Mm-hmm. Because you work in the humanities mm-hmm. department at mm-hmm. the university mm-hmm. and you understand that conflict, mm-hmm. what do you think we can do as humanities people to make it known that the importance and the value of teaching the humanities at every age? Mm-hmm.
I have so many answers for that, but like the first one I know for sure, like my students who read a lot, I mean, when anyone asks me, how do I be a better writer? I'm like, you read a lot. And any job you have, I don't care if you're an engineer, I don't care if you're an accountant, you have to write and you have to express yourself in some way. So if you're reading, you're gonna have that part of your life be better. But I also, again, I read somewhere that they were having doctors take great books courses because it made them more empathetic in their bedside manner. And I think that sort of idea that, again, that having that sort of empathy and being able to relate with peoples and things that you aren't sure of helps you in any position of your job. You know, if you're an engineer and you've read a bunch of Indian fiction and you know how Indian society and caste and religion works, you're gonna be able to do your job better if you're working with someone who is from a different place. And I think your understanding of that is better. Again, I think if your world is bigger, every part of your life is just better. And I really believe that. I've taught long enough now that I've had students that have come back and said to me, you know, I didn't really want to take your class. It was a requirement. I had to do it to take a lit class or fill a diversity requirement. I still think about those books. I think about those stories. I think about all of these things. I have an engineering student who went on to Stanford, and she keeps in touch with me all the time and says, I've thought about that thing we read. And I think those things don't leave you the way maybe some quick facts do.
Right. Well, it's so great talking to you. And thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us for this episode of What's Your Why? A production of Think Why, Wyoming Humanities. This has been executive producer Emmy DeGrappa. Please subscribe and never miss a show. For more information, go to thinkwhy.org.